As we're here at the midnight screening of Blood Diner with director Jackie Kong, and I'm going as Mr. Stan, Mr. Stan's Veggies, and I've got, I call him the Putty Man. He doesn't have an actual name, but when I watched this movie, I used to call him the Putty Man because his face looked like silly putty.
Let me give you money.
I love you, honey. Let me give you money. I love you, honey. Let me give you money. I love you, honey. Let me give you money. I love you, honey. Let me give you money.
Creative people from the film who are special guests tonight.
Introduce Jurg, Walther, the cinematographer. Stand up, Jurg.
You're welcome to come up here too. Yeah, we have a microphone as well.
Don Preston, the composer of the score. phenomenal. As well as the cinematography, Jurg will explain how we did that in such a short period of time.
Yeah, please come up. There is one more microphone down to your side. You just need to flip
on the switch. Don Preston is the original member of Frank Zappa's Mothers of Invention.
Now, I did mention we're going to give some stuff away. Normally we do some trivia questions, and we may have a few as well. But first, if you dressed up for the show tonight, or you are in a Blood Diner t-shirt of some sort, please come up. We want to give you free stuff.
So if you'd like me to sign it later, stick around.
Oh, yes.
Well, we have the dummy friend. For those of you who have not seen the film, you'll understand who this is.
All right. And the movie was shot in 18 days. And Jackie was so well prepared. Every shot was completely designed.
And every lighting diagram was laid out well in advance, as well as rehearsed. So you'll see how, and we have hundreds of extras in this film. In fact, we have one here with us. I apologize in advance for making you lay on the ground forever.
But this is a grand scene dancer. Now we do have a few more stills left. So I'm gonna ask a few questions. Raise your hand if you know the answer to any of these. If you've been following our event page.
Can I ask a question?
Oh yeah, go ahead. Ask whatever you like.
Witness, if you know the name of the band leader that gets his brains blown out at the end of the film, anyone name that guy?
Mr. Crimson.
The King of White Trash. No one knew that. Okay. What about the wrestler in the wrestling scene that fights George? Little Jimmy.
Yeah, we see him back on the corner there. Yeah.
Little Jimmy Hitler?
Yes.
Please come
on. Come on down.
An exclusive still of Jackie Kong
directing Little Jimmy Hitler.
Jackie Kong has been interviewed by Fangoria magazine twice. Who knows what issues either of those were in? I see a hand right there in the center.
Wild guess and say 17.
70, that's good enough.
Good enough. Please come up. Issue 70 and issue 330.
And I have an announcement to make.
Oh, yeah, please do.
Fangoria would like to make another Jackie Kong movie.
Yeah.
All of you, after you see this film, if you want to see another Jackie Kong movie, send a note to Fangoria on their Facebook, and we're in dialogue right now. So
oh, awesome.
Let's,
yeah.
Woo!
Yes, I was featured in their latest issue, October. 4 pages remembering Blood Diner. Mm-hmm. So, and I wanted to also clear up one thing. I am not a man. that seems to go around the internet for quite a while that a woman could not direct a horror film like this. When you see it, you will see what they. It's pretty out there. So, especially when I directed it. So. I wanted to let you know that the U.S. seemed to take a longer time than the rest of the world finding this film, but I'm glad it finally did and caught up with it.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, I would say that of your four features, this one seems to be the one that has had the most longevity and has kind of developed the largest cult following. I mean, I might be mistaken, and I know this wasn't your most commercially successful film. That would probably be Night Patrol with Linda Blair and The Unknown Comic and Andrew Dice Clay and so many others. But I think Blood Diner seems to be the one that has
stood
the test
of
time.
To answer that question, why I think is because the censors were on us so badly when I made this film. I think it was ahead of its time as far as when you see it. The censors shut it off and they wouldn't rate the film. So the film had to go out unrated. And that wasn't a problem in Europe and in Asia and in the rest of the world, but in the U.S., you can't take a film out unrated without a lot of restrictions. So the film was apparently had no social redeeming quality.
That's why we like it.
So you tell me what you think. was made in the 80s, and I was in my 20s. So a couple of decades ago, so it was like years ahead of its time. When you see it now, it's still surprising, and you're seeing it on the big screen, which is the way we intended it to be seen. Jurg and I shot it 35 millimeter. You'll see several layers of action that you cannot see on the Blu-ray or on the VHS. So those of you who've seen the film, keep your eyes open. Those of you who haven't, this is the way it should be seen.
And I do want to mention the restoration of this film and the resurrection. In, I believe, late 2016, you premiered the new restored version of this film, and I believe it was in an Alamo Draft House in Austin, Texas.
Yes, we went on the Insanity Tour, Blood Diner Insanity Tour, with this DCP, with what you're seeing today, because of the re-release of the film, because really the fans insisted on there being a release that kicked off Lionsgate's Best Drawn series of horror films. So we had that honor of going back into the lab with the original negative, Jurg and I, original three-stripe soundtrack, and what you're seeing is a fully remastered film from the negative. So it was by popular demand, really.
Yeah, and just to let everyone know, I actually helped Jackie a bit behind the scenes on this tour, both creating some shitar suits for the live shitar appearances at some of the shows, and the DJ mix of the Blood for the Blood Diner party, some of which was playing before the show. And I'll just display this really quick here, one of our shitars from the tour.
Yes, we have
a nice shitar piece.
This makes no sense whatsoever. But in the film, there is a goddess that is resurrected. You'll find out about it. But we literally hit the streets in New Orleans, Vancouver, Seattle, San Francisco, New York with this outfit, with the new and improved shitar, which was an incredible transvestite.
Is that the correct term to use anymore? But there's a lot of incorrect terms
okay.
in the movie.
All right.
I don't know. I'm not saying it is or not.
It's politically incorrect. Okay.
Actually, every Saturday night we do have Sweet Transvestite here, and so if anyone who's come to Rocky Horror knows how ridiculously wild we get.
In the film, I don't want any spoilers, but you'll see. It's the new. We went out with the new and improved shitar. And it was a fun party, let's just put it that way.
And I myself have not seen this restored version, so I'm very excited to sit down in the audience with you all and see this.
Okay, and a couple of quick things I just wanted to mention. Noticed on the tour, when we were touring around the country, all over from Austin to New York to Kansas City, Denver, and then the West Coast, that there are more female horror fans now than ever before. And that was the big thing I noticed on tour from when I made the film decades ago, that was really more for a male audience, or that was the fan base. Now, including my daughter who loves horror films, there are more female fans, and that's a big difference that I've seen. That's again why they thought I was a man, they didn't think I was a woman to direct this film. Because there are no having a Q&A afterwards. I just wanted to do a
quick
plug. My daughter is playing at Creation Cafe, and I will be there tomorrow night. So if you have any questions after you see this film, go there, and I will answer your questions. It's Creation Cafe in Venice, not the one in Hollywood, Venice.
Yeah, we'll put some postcards out by the cake for anyone who wants.
Yes, and cake, please join us for cake afterwards. Any quick questions?
Yeah, let's take a few questions before we start the film. All the way in the back.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So, we went and ate at Greco's now, which is the original Blood Diner.
On the corner of Cahuenga and Hollywood Boulevard is where I shot the film, which
yes.
is now Pizza Parlor,
yes.
right? Yeah.
So, I want to know, what were the challenges of shooting in a space so small?
No. In fact, that back room was a phony wall, movie magic, where you would go through that. We took that wall everywhere with us. You go through the door, and then we shot the back room, completely different location in Hollywood, on a club that used to be called, it was a club on Hollywood and La Brea, yes. And it was shut down. It was a speakeasy. We built several sets there. The big finale was shot there. The back room of the diner, which that place was so small, we had to gel all the windows for all the new techies out there, cinematographers. We had to gel everything so that we could, and even then inside that diner was like 120 degrees with all our lights. Yeah, because it was in the middle of summer. And so watch those scenes carefully. You'll see that's the area where you'll see several layers of action going on. Foreground, mid-ground, street action. All happening, you can see it on the big room. But there, it was challenging.
Any more questions for any of our
guests?
Yeah, back over there.
How much was the budget? What did you expect to spend, and what were you guys actually working with?
The budget was probably the budget of most films' catering budget. Nothing. It was so challenging that I couldn't go SAG, and the producer said, "You have to, Jackie. You're a good director. You'll figure it out." So what I did is I ended up working with all punk rock bands and musicians, and rehearsed them for like a month and a half ahead of time. But the budget was minuscule, less than $300,000.
Actually, Francine, the answer up here, did mention how much the budget was. She said about a bag of potato chips.
Yeah, I remember the atmosphere being pretty upset because we have about 100 extras in that big finale scene, and they're laying there forever, covered with blood. Well, Carol syrup, both of our phony. It was the cheap blood, Carol syrup, that's what we used, and food coloring. And I think someone complained on Facebook that all they were fed, all we could afford was a loaf of bread and bologna. Do you remember that? I don't recall because I was so busy working. I was doing 90 setups a day on that finale sequence. So on the last 10 minutes of the film, with 100 extras, prosthetics, special effects, I was shooting 90 setups a day. And
we did
fully planned out shots. I mean, not a random shot in the film.
And we had a completion bond company.
Oh yes, and
40%.
I had a bond company on top of me. You know what
budget.
They did is they actually would never do this to a man. I have to say, I had made Night Patrol. Night Patrol was a hit, and they made me put up my salary before I would invade the bond because they had no faith in the fact that I could complete this film on time. But we did it, and then I won't even go into the details of trying to collect my salary because that was quite a scene at the bond company because I that was a deal. The minute I wrapped, they would pay me, and they didn't want to pay me. So
they kept breathing down their necks.
Yeah. Right, because they're a little bit afraid to take over the film because the budget was so small. Any other questions?
Do you have like a really ridiculous story, like something that happened on set that you just remember to this day, like
the whole
thing, like anything go wrong or anything like that?
Even the dummy, we leave it on the car in front of the set, and nobody bothered us. They thought that we were insane. And then the Teamsters showed up and they wanted to shut us down because we weren't union. And they took a look at me and they took a look at Tiki Goldberg, my production manager, who was another woman with frizzy hair. And I said, look, they came to me and they threatened me, basically. You've got to go to union, you're going to blow up something. And so they looked, I said, you go talk to my production manager. And Tiki, remember Tiki?
Yeah.
With that hair, and she's groaning all the time. Oh, she's always moaning. I don't know why. And they looked at her, and they looked at me, and they said, oh, forget it, and they left. And we were literally shooting a block from the union headquarters on Cahuenga. So they just left us alone.
What were your influences when developing the story?
Oh, that's a good question. The producers, when you see this film, it was written serious as a heart attack, okay? And when I read it, I didn't see the film that the producers initially saw. So I wanted to, for example, the two leads are incredibly good looking guys. When you see them, you want to date them, they're so good looking. And this was very upsetting to the producers because I cast two, you know, that was written to be two ghoulish guys that you could tell were murderers from across the street. And so I wanted to make them super likable. And this upset the rating board. This was one of the things that upset the rating board. They said, how can you have these mass killers be so likable? You'll like them. The only thing is, we had this thing in San Francisco, we opened the film that, you know, you see them, they're so good looking, and you win a date with the Tetman boys. And these had not seen the film yet, but they won the date, and when they saw the film, the girls didn't show up. So you tell me if you would date these guys. But I wanted to make them attractive, and that was an influence, mainly because at that time there were these guys bombing abortion clinics that were like really like the pillars of the community, good looking, and they would sit in court saying God told them to bomb the abortion clinics, and that was what I decided to pattern. That was the influence for these two guys.
All right, we're gonna wrap this up now.
So
if you have any more questions.
See me afterwards. Don, do you have anything you want to say about the score really quick? The score? Do you want to say anything about the score?
Well, it was quite a challenge to write music here for some of the scenes in the movie, once again, with the budget, I fortunately had a modular Moog at the time, and did most of the, I performed all of the instruments myself in the score. And it was all synthesized, but
so you have to understand Don's range as a composer is he can do any type of music genre, opera, rock and roll, everything. It's like his range is amazing. So as a composer, certain composers do one thing. Don can do it all, and he is one of the pioneers on the Moog synthesizer. So I wanted to just point that out.
Yeah, you'll see how important the music is in the movie.
Every place, every character has its own theme. So if you want to talk to me afterwards, that's one of the reasons why you feel the presence of certain people and things when they're not there, because everybody has a theme. The resurrection has a theme. The diner has a theme. The Michael, the main character, has a theme that's hypnotic. So it's a sort of a cinema trick to create this presence of characters that aren't there and to make you think of them and subconsciously. So anyway, hope to see you at Creation Cafe tomorrow with some questions if I don't see you afterwards.
Yes, and I want to thank you, Jackie, thank you, Jurg, thank you, Dawn, thank you, Francine, and thank all of you for coming out to this movie tonight.